scrambling to figure out a plan. You might recall this viral video we showed you last week that reignited health concerns about in-person learning this year. A high schooler posted this packed school hallway photo from Paulding County, Georgia. That student was suspended for posting the photo. Actually, the school then moved back to online learning after reporting 9 cases of COVID-19. By the way, the suspension, it was essentially lifted. I don't know if the individual spent any time out, but because of the pushback nationally, they backed off of that. But there were 9 kids that have tested positive. So today and tomorrow, they're closed down there. So joining us now to weigh in on the impact of reopening schools during a pandemic is psychologist Dr. Toby Watson. Dr. Watson, thanks for joining us, sir. Tell me how we go about this. Everybody wants to go back to school. Nobody wants to get any COVID cases, but we know neither one is pure.
Absolutely. And I think everybody agrees that children need to be back in school. We know that going to school increases their connectedness to the school. It lowers depression and suicide. There's studies that were done that showed that increase in substance abuse happens when they're not connected to their school and returning to school. The challenge is that I think we kind of have some unions right now, the teachers union in particular, that is really getting a lot of pushback, and it's not putting children first. And I think that's the problem for a long time, is that we need to serve the function of children rather than children serving the function of us adults. We know that children don't really contract COVID-19 for the most part, and when they do, they're pretty asymptomatic. And the death rate is extremely low. It's like 0.1%. You're much more likely to die of the flu than actually COVID-19. So we know they don't transmit it. So a lot of the...
Wait a minute. You just said we know they don't transmit it. We don't know they don't transmit it.
Well, I should say they transmit at a lower rate than adults do. And thank you for the clarification. They don't transmit at the same rate that adults do.
Okay.
So if you're going to be around people, it's more likely, you know, better to be around children than it is adults right now. And I think one of the big concerns that a lot of people have is that we're asking children to jump through a lot of hoops that may not be necessary for children, especially when we offset that with the emotional, social, and educational needs that these children really need.
Yeah. My wife's a teacher, so we've had these conversations, and that's why I'm aware that kids can transmit it, but they can also take it home to their grandparents that are living with them, or, you know, that sort of thing. But I don't know. We may be at a point where America says, okay, there's a risk, but we still got to get back to school. We still got to get back to work. How do you balance those things?
I think the way that we balance is that, again, we try to serve the function of children, not the function of adults.
And how is that different, doctor? How what different decisions would you make if you did that?
For example, I mean, we're asking children to wear face coverings, young children, which we know they'll futz and touch their mask much more, which will actually increase the likelihood of them actually potentially having cross-contamination.
Mm-hmm.
We know that they aren't the ones that are really vulnerable. The teachers are more vulnerable. The administrators are more vulnerable. So it may be that we look at the interventions for them, social distancing the teachers, maybe having the teachers change classrooms rather than the children change classrooms. Lunches that outside or, you know, in the classrooms, there's not as much walking through the hallways.
Right.
There's a lot of ideas that we can do to serve the children's function rather than try to put them into our, you know, category and say, no, we're scared for ourselves as adults, and therefore we're going to, like, impose these restrictions and things on children where we really don't know the full impact that it's going to have. We know, though, children use, you know, facial recognition to develop empathy, to learn those meta communication skills, you know, should I raise my hand, should I not, does Sally like me or not? And if we put a mask on them, it's very difficult for them to recognize that.
Right.
And we don't know the true impact it's going to have or whether that's actually going to be worse. I mean, we know headaches come from wearing these masks. That's one of the number one things in the nursing research, if you look at it, that nurses don't like them after a long period of time, and they get headaches and fatigue. I think we're dealing with something totally new.
Yeah.
But we need to put the children first and look at them and say, hey, what can we do for them at this time?
All very good points. I look forward to the day that we could take these things, take them outside and burn them. I don't know when that happens, but I look forward to it. Thank you for your observations, Dr. Toby Watson there. Thank you for joining us. And